We're saying that here in New York, women's health matters. We're saying here in New York, women's lives matter. We're saying here in New York, women's decisions matter.
Assemble the army!
I'm talking pedicure on my toes, trying on all our clothes,
I look at you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
Goodbye.
Could it be safe?
Welcome, one and all, to the number one Catholic podcast on the internet, Cafeteria Catholics, here on your chest, Catholicism, and I am your first responder Catholic, Ephraim Cortez, coming to you from the great city of Lexington, Kentucky. Great to be back behind the Cafeteria Catholics microphone. Just got back from a trip, my wife and I. We flew out to New York. Just got back a few days ago. Not a fun trip. Not a fun trip whatsoever. Not a vacation by any stretch of the imagination. Had someone on my mom's side of the family pass away, my aunt Cristina Garcia. Please pray for her soul. And Garcia, that's my aunt's husband's name. My mom's side of the family, their last name is Rosa. And so Garcia is my aunt's husband's last name. An incredible man, by the way. My uncle, he's my uncle. But an incredible man, an incredible husband, unparalleled patience. My aunt, she passed away from Parkinson's. She contracted the illness back some years ago. And the entire time, her husband, whom I consider to be my uncle, he never left her side. You know how sometimes you'll have a married couple, one of them gets sick, and the other spouse decides, I can't handle this. I don't want to be with this person anymore for whatever reason. And they leave. Well, my uncle is the complete opposite. The guy stuck with her the entire time. He wheeled her everywhere in her wheelchair. Took her to Puerto Rico. Incredible. You know, it's a pain in the ass sometimes just traveling with your spouse when they're normal, right? We flew to New York and it's a pain in the butt having to deal with my wife, right? I'm sure it's a pain in the butt having to deal with me, right? Just adds to the stress of traveling because it's stressful, especially nowadays, to travel, right? You got to take off your shoes. You got to make sure you're there on time. You know, it's just a pain in the butt, right? So, my uncle, just an incredible example of what it is to be a husband, to be a patient husband, to be a dedicated husband. I can only pray and hope that if my wife were to contract some sort of a illness, that I could be half the man, a quarter, a fifth of the man, the husband, that my uncle was to my aunt, okay? And so just an incredible man, right? But we had to fly out there, and we kind of knew that it was coming. It was bad there at the end. So we knew that perhaps we were going to have to fly out there. And I didn't know what to do there at the end. I didn't know because I knew that it was bad. She was in a hospice, and so I knew that it was bad. And so I didn't know what to do. I didn't know whether to fly out there and, you know, see her while she was still alive. Should I wait and, you know, go out there for the funeral? I didn't know what to do. And so I decided, hey, I'm going to fly out of here and try to see her while she's still alive. But it didn't turn out that way. She ended up passing away the day before we flew out. And so it just didn't work out. Didn't get to see her while she was alive. And I almost didn't get to see her while she was dead, right? I almost had to fly back home without seeing her, even in a box. Because there was this whole mix-up with the insurance and, you know, the cemetery wanted to be paid up front. And yeah, it was just a big mess, you know? Anytime someone dies, it can become an incredible mess, okay? And that's what it turned into. A mess. But thankfully, they made some sort of an arrangement there at the end, and my wife and I, we were able to see my aunt before we flew back out to Kentucky, back to Kentucky. And so thank God for that, because there was closure there for me. You know, I remember seeing this movie one time, a long time ago. It was a Vin Diesel movie. And he played an undercover cop, and he makes this big bust. And after he makes this big bust, you know, the bad guys, they sneak into his house in the middle of the night, and they leave him and his wife for dead. They shoot up the place, leave him for dead. Okay? Well, Vin Diesel's character, he ends up in a coma for, I forget how long, but while he's in a coma, his wife ends up not making it. She dies. So he wakes up from the coma, and they tell him, you know, your wife is dead. You know, she passed away. They buried her in the whole thing, the whole nine yards, while he was in a coma. And in spite of the fact that he was told by his friends, you know, his cop friends, that she died, it's like he just couldn't believe it. You know, he had to see the tombstone for himself. He had to go to the cemetery and see the tombstone with her name on it. And then, you know, it sunk in, and he accepted it, and he believed it. You know, and that's kind of the way that it was for me. In spite of the fact that I had my family telling me, you know, she passed away, you know, I'm not there, so I'm not seeing the entire thing. You know, I'm not seeing the whole picture. I'm not at the hospital. I'm not seeing how bad off she was. And so, in spite of the fact that I've got my family telling me she passed away, it's like I had to see it for myself. I needed confirmation. You know, I needed closure. And so, when I finally saw her, it's like, okay, you know, I can accept it. You know? It's hard to accept, but there was closure there, and there was confirmation. You know, and the funny thing is, you know how when someone passes away, you know, you get all of these memories of things that they said and did and so forth, you know? With my aunt, I just don't have a memory of her saying anything, you know? A few words, you know? But my aunt was very, very quiet, very meek, very humble. And so I can probably remember 10 words that she spoke the entire time. You know, I think about her anytime that I read, you know, the Gospel of Luke. You know, and it talks about how Mary pondered all of these things in her heart. You know, the Blessed Mother didn't say a whole lot, right? She didn't say much in the scripture. And we are told that she pondered all of these things in her heart. And that's kind of the person that my aunt was. You know, she pondered all of these things in her heart, I assume, because she never really spoke. You know, she didn't speak. And, you know, it kind of runs on my mother's side of the family. You know, I've got an uncle that doesn't really speak a whole lot, you know. I'm a very quiet guy myself. My mom's pretty quiet, you know. But I'm a pretty quiet guy, you know, just because you hear me on, you know, the podcast here behind the Cafeteria Catholics microphone. You know, I get diarrhea of the mouth when I see the red light go on here, you know, on the Spreaker console. But I'm actually a very quiet guy, you know. And my aunt, I mean, I'm like, you know, compared to my aunt, I'm like, you know, a talk show host all the time, you know, because she just didn't say a whole lot. But it's incredible how you don't need to say a whole lot to make an impact, an indelible impact in the lives of many. Because she didn't say much. But the entire family, she just made an indelible impression, an indelible mark in our hearts, right? I will never forget her. And I will never forget, I mean, she didn't say a whole lot, but I remember back a couple of years ago, I was in New York, and I was at my mom's house, and the whole family got together at my mom's house. And my aunt, you know, came over. Of course, my uncle had to bring her, you know, he had to push the wheelchair quite a few blocks to get to my mom's house. And he brings my aunt there. And, you know, it's a struggle at this point. You know, she was pretty advanced with the Parkinson's disease at that point. And it was a struggle for her to make it up the stoop, you know, there's a few steps there, steep steps that she had to climb. Of course, my uncle and I, we helped her out of the wheelchair, but for the most part, she climbed those steps by herself. You know, you gotta climb the stoop steps, then after that, you know, there's another set of steps, and then, you know, she's gotta make it into the apartment. And, you know, we've got to get the wheelchair ready for her, and we got to help her into the wheelchair. I mean, it was just, you know, it's a struggle for her to make it to my mom's house, you know, to my mom's apartment, to come see me. And so, you know, she's going through all of this, and the family is quiet, you know, which is a miracle, you know. My family is just not the quiet type, right? There's a couple of quiet people in the family, but my family is predominantly, you know, very, very boisterous, you know. And so the fact that they were quiet, but of course they're quiet because they're seeing my aunt go through all of this effort. And no one wants to see a family member suffer, right? And so everyone is quiet. And so I decide I'm going to break the ice a little bit. And, you know, I say to her, you know, you're going through all of this for me. I'm not that important, you know. I'm trying to crack a joke there, you know. And, you know, some of my family members, they laugh, you know. But she looks at me and she says, "You are important." And I wasn't expecting that. You know, it kind of floored me, took me aback that she said that, you know, that she went through all of that to come see me, right? And I was joking, but at the same time, you know, I was being serious. I mean, I'm not that important for you to go through all of this just to come see me. You could have stayed home, you know? But she says, "You are important." And I will never forget those words. Right? And so sometimes, you know, a person doesn't have to say a whole lot for them to make an impression on you, for them to leave an indelible mark in your heart, in your soul, in your being. And so please pray for my aunt, Cristina Garcia, and please pray for her husband, Gregorio Garcia, and please pray for my family as we deal with this loss. But anyway, so I'm in New York, and, you know, during the time we're there, of course, you've got this abortion law that Cuomo, Governor Cuomo, signs into place in New York, where it is now legal to abort a child in the third trimester, even up to birth. Incredible. We're talking about infanticide at this point. You know, there, I can see, even though, you know, factually it's not true, but I can see where some people might actually believe, hey, you know, at 2 months, 1 month, we're talking about a bundle of a flesh. You know, it's just it's not even, you know, it's not a formed baby, right? I can see the argument at 1 month, 2 months, even though it's medically not accurate to say that. I can see, you know, I can see the validity of certain people believing that or wanting to believe that in order to justify an abortion. But at birth, we're not talking about, a mound of flesh anymore, a mound of tissue anymore. We're talking about a human being. And you've got the New York legislature giving a standing ovation at the signing of this evil bill. You've heard me say many times before that the Democrat Party is a party of death. They are the party of death. Everything they stand for, everything they advocate, advances the cause of death. Sodomy, death. Contraception, death. Abortion, death. And you've got this Andrea Stewart Cousins, who is the majority leader of the New York Assembly there. And you heard her at the top of the show. This is what she has to say.
We're saying that here in New York, women's health matters. We're saying here in New York, women's lives matter. We're saying here in New York, women's decisions matter.
You see what happens when you are on the side of lies? On the side of deception, on the side of doublespeak, you contradict yourself. How can you say that you are for women's health and support abortion? How can you say that you are for women's lives and support abortion? How can you say that you are for women's decision-making and support abortion? What about all of the potential women who are not here with us because of abortion? They have no health. They have no lives. And they have no decision-making whatsoever because of abortion. Which you have played a big, huge part in New York in advancing. And now we have infanticide in New York. This is not abortion. This is infanticide. We can now kill children at birth in New York. And it pains for me to say it because I'm, at heart, a New Yorker, born and raised in New York. And here they are killing babies at birth, at my place of birth. But these Democrats, They are a walking, talking ball of contradiction. And you are going to contradict yourself when you oppose truth. Because the fact of the matter is that abortion is not for women's health. It has nothing to do with women's health. Abortion has nothing to do with women's lives. Except that you annihilate a life through the act of abortion. And it has nothing to do with women's decision making. Health. Abortion does not equal women's health. The Guttmacher Institute, the research arm of Planned Parenthood, they admit that a woman who undergoes an abortion will later in life perhaps develop PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. How does abortion advance women's health? It doesn't. Post-traumatic stress disorder has nothing to do. Is post-traumatic stress disorder a healthy thing? A soldier who goes out and has to kill the enemy, or perhaps sees his friends being killed by the enemy, his friends being blown up, perhaps he himself losing a limb. A soldier who undergoes such traumatic events, he might come back and develop PTSD. PTSD is not a healthy thing. A woman who is raped, who is the victim of rape, may later develop PTSD. PTSD is not a healthy thing. But PTSD can be developed by a woman who undergoes an abortion. And so to say that abortion is a healthy thing, that it has an iota of relevance when it comes to women's health, this is just, it's an outright lie. It is an outright lie. And when you embrace a lie, when you embrace the manipulation of language, and when you embrace a half-truth, you are going to contradict yourselves. The Democrat Party is a walking, talking ball of contradiction. The Democrat Party is the party of death. Always has been. Always has been. Democrat Party has always been on the wrong side of perhaps every issue. It's been on the wrong side of race from the beginning. Democrat Party founded the KKK. This is a historical fact. Democrat Party, Democrats in general, fought. They spilled their blood all over this country to ensure that slavery would go on. Wrong side of the issue from the beginning. Wrong side of the issue. And they are on the wrong side of the issue as it pertains to abortion. Here we have Governor Cuomo.
I say bittersweet because there is a bitterness, because we shouldn't be here in the first place. We should not have a federal government that is trying to roll back women's rights to a point 47, 48, 50 years ago. This administration defies American evolution. We're supposed to be moving forward. We're supposed to be advancing. We're supposed to live and learn. We're supposed to be growing. And there is.
How can we grow and yet at the same time eliminate our own citizens? How can we advance and at the same time annihilate our citizenry? How do we advance? How do we grow? How do we live and learn? Seems to me we're not learning anything. The more advanced, quote-unquote, we become, the less we learn. How do we, at this point, almost 50 years into it, how do we at this point, how is it that we have not learned that abortion is not a good thing? Eliminating our own people is not a good thing. How can we be so advanced and yet not know that? How do we not know that even economically abortion is not a good thing? How many taxpayers have we eradicated? You know, the Democrat Party, they're the party of big government. They love big government. They love giving stuff away, right? Well, in order for that to happen, we need taxpayers, do we not? They are a walking, talking ball of contradiction.
Entire perspective on the world is a retrospective. We're going to go back, take you back to the good old days instead of take us forward.
Going back. Well, if going back means saving lives, potential lives, then by all means, let's go back. Let's go back to a time when the womb was considered to be a safe place. Let's do that. I don't want to go forward. I don't want to go forward. Not in New York, anyway. Not in New York. Sorry to say. Now, when we get back, let's go ahead and take a break. When we get back, we will play a pretty good-sized portion of the signing of this atrocious evil bill in New York City. Let's go ahead and take a break. We'll see you on the other side. Please, fellow Catholics, do not touch that mouse.
Jesus has asked us to be there. It is a place where you can experience a taste of heaven, a place where the holy saints come to worship with the angels and the Blessed Virgin Mary. A place where you can be in personal communion with Jesus Christ and hear God's message inspired by His Holy Spirit. Yes, Jesus has asked us to be there. For it is at Holy Mass that Christ comes personally to every altar to be intimate with us, to nourish us. We live in a broken world that longs for healing, grace, and renewal. Many feel alone and are searching for peace. Jesus has asked us to be there because He knows what we need. It is through His passion and death that He's offered us a spiritual feast so our emptiness can be filled and our lives can be made new. He wants us to be there so we can be fully alive. Jesus is inviting us. Will we be there?
It was the night of the Last Supper. Jesus knew the time had come for Him to leave the world. Yet He wanted to remain with us just as personally as if He had never left. How did He accomplish this? By instituting the priesthood. From generation to generation, He would handpick men to minister in His person. St. John Vianney said, "If we were to fully realize what a priest is on earth, we would die, not of fright, but of love." Is this really how we view our priests? Even though priests are human and imperfect, they bring us the sacraments, including the forgiveness of sins. It is through the office of the priesthood that Christ accomplishes His saving work. How can we not then pray for our priests, affirm them, and lift them up? St. Vianney said, "What use would be a house filled with gold were there no one to open its door?" The priest holds the key to the treasures of heaven. It is he who opens the door.
We We call it the information superhighway. And like any other road we drive on, the internet is always leading us somewhere. Now, we all know the internet can take us to wonderful, life-giving places. And there's a lot of stuff online that leads us away from fullness of life. So how do we know which is which? Maybe it's as simple as asking ourselves, is the internet a place we go to become more whole and fully alive? Is it a source of grace and truth, or something that ultimately tears us down? See, Jesus made it clear. He came so we could have life to the fullest. He wants our relationships to be whole and healthy and our lives to be full of grace. And ultimately, he wants our journey here on earth to lead to eternity with him in heaven. How could we ever allow anything to compromise the fullness of life that Christ offers us, both in this life and the next? Where is your time on the information superhighway leading you?
What's going on, fellow Catholics? We are back. Cafeteria Catholics, where we say what most Catholics are thinking. And I don't want to move forward. Don't want to move forward if it means that we are going to move forward with blood on our hands. The blood of unborn babies. I don't want to do that. Let's go back to the good old days, as we are told by Governor Cuomo.
I say bittersweet because there is a bitterness, because we shouldn't be here in the first place. We should not have a federal government that is trying to roll back women's rights to a point 47, 48, 50 years ago. This administration defies American evolution. We're supposed to be moving forward. We're supposed to be advancing. We're supposed to live and learn. We're supposed to be growing. And their entire perspective on the world is a retrospective. We're going to go back, take you back to the good old days, instead of take us forward.
Take you back to the good old days. We can't live and learn. We can't live with abortion. That's a contradiction. Walking ball of contradiction, the Democrat Party. We can't live with abortion. We can't learn with abortion. Can't do any of that stuff. We can't advance. We can't go forward. We can't live. We can't learn. We can't grow with abortion, because abortion is death. All of these other things, living, learning, going forward, advancing, these are all things that only the living can do, not the dead. And it is abortion that equals death. How can we go forward? How can we live? How can we learn? How can we advance? How can we grow with abortion? Makes no sense whatsoever. But hey, this is the state of New York, unfortunately, today, under the governorship of Cuomo. And as promised, let's go ahead and take a listen to a longer version of this signing of this bill last week. And hold on to your seats, because contradiction is on the way.
Congratulations, congratulations, congratulations. Let's give a warm welcome to all the advocates who have worked so long and so hard for so many years. And let's give a round of applause to all the legislators who finally got it done. We took the vote.
Don't forget, these people are applauding. It's not even abortion. They are applauding infanticide in New York City. All the hard work, all the fighting for infanticide, for death. This is the party of death, the Democrat Party.
And we have a special guest of honor. It couldn't come together any better than it's come together today. Sarah Weddington, who argued Roe v. Wade, here today on the 46th anniversary of Roe v. Wade. Let's give Sarah a big round of applause. This evening is a little bittersweet for me. Sweet because we won. And we won after a long, long, long fight. And for the advocacy community, what you have done here, the way you stayed with it, Planned Parenthood led by Robin Chappell Golson, the National Institute of Reproductive Health and Andrea Miller, Now and Sonia Osorio, NYCLU, Donna Lieberman, the ACOG, congratulations, congratulations, congratulations. To the legislators who would never give up the fight, I first applaud the legislative leader, Speaker Carl Heastie, who's doing a great job. Senate Leader Andrea Stewart Cousins, who brought a new fresh breath. To Assembly Member Deborah Glick, who Assemblymember Deborah Glick, who has made an entire career out of being the first at the head of the crusade to fight for human equality and human rights for every human being. We have such respect for you. God bless you. Another round of applause for Deborah Glick.
Human rights for equality. For the civil rights of every human being. Unless you happen to be in the womb. See, a complete contradiction. For the civil rights of every human being. And yet here she is in support of abortion. In support of the annihilation of the human being. The destruction of the human being. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable that these people, they're blinded. They are blinded. They are blinded by the spirit of death. They are haunted by the spirit of death. These are people, Democrat Party, they are the party of death. They have embraced death. You know, you've got Nancy Pelosi out there talking about how building a wall is immoral. That's immoral. The woman is anti-wall. She's anti-wall, right? And I guess it makes sense. I mean, she's against the uterine wall, right? She wants to interfere with the uterine wall, so why not interfere with the border wall, right? The border wall is immoral.
The fact is, a wall is an immorality. It's not who we are as a nation.
It's not who we are as a nation. She's against walls. You know, the funny thing is, I'm watching this back, what was it, a few weeks ago, last month or so. She's in there. She's at the Oval Office with Trump and with Chuck Schumer, her buddy there, her pro-death buddy there. They're together, and she's at the White House talking about how walls do not work. And yet, she says this at the very moment that she and Schumer are sitting at perhaps the most fortified walls in the world. They are in the White House. She is behind walls, behind perhaps the most protected walls in the world. And yet, at the same time, she is saying that walls don't work. Well, they seem to be working just fine at the White House. They seem to be working just fine at the legislature. Legislature in New York, by the way, as well. They seem to be well protected over there. They don't mind those walls, right? But they have something against a border wall. They have something against the uterine wall. It's okay for an illegal immigrant to climb over a border wall, right? Climb over a fence. That's okay. Climb over, you know, the border wall if that's what you want to do. That's fine. We're not going to do anything about it, right? But God forbid a fetus tries to attach itself to the uterine wall. We've got to do something about that, do we not? We've got to intervene. We've got to interfere. We've got to abort. We've got to murder these potential American citizens from attaching themselves to the uterine wall. By the way, another contradiction. You know, you've got these pro-death advocates who are for contraception. And part of their argument is that, the morning after pill, for example, birth does not take place, or conception does not take place, until the human being is born, until the baby is born, right? And so prior to that, we can do whatever we want to interrupt life, right? Contraception, for example, contraception. It thins the uterine wall. Not just talking about the morning after pill, but contraception in general, right? The pill in general thins the uterine wall. And so therefore, the baby cannot attach itself to the uterine wall because it's been thinned, chemically thinned, right? Problem is, how is it if life begins after birth? There is no conception after death. Or after birth, or before birth, there's no conception. Conception takes place after birth, according to these pro-death advocates, right? Then how is it that the fetus, prior to birth, can attach itself to anything? Don't you have to be alive to attach yourself to a wall? You know, Spider-Man, for example. I love Spider-Man, right? Spider-Man, one of his special powers is that he attaches himself to the wall. Now, let's say the Green Goblin comes around, and, you know, he does away with Spider-Man. He gets the best of Spider-Man, and he kills Spider-Man. Once Spider-Man is dead, is he going to be able to attach himself to walls? No, he's not. Because he's dead. You have to be alive in order to attach yourself to any wall, right? Spider-Man has to be alive in order for him to walk on walls, to attach himself to walls. He's got to be alive first, right? Doesn't it make sense that, you know, the fetus would have to be alive in order for the fetus to attach itself to the uterine wall? wouldn't be able to attach itself to the uterine wall if it was dead. If it wasn't animated, if it didn't have life within it. Right? And so they contradict themselves. And the reason they contradict themselves is because they are embracing a lie. Life begins at conception, right? It doesn't begin after birth. Conception doesn't, you know, take place after birth. Life doesn't begin after birth, right? It begins at conception. This is when life begins. But they are against walls. Walls are immoral, right? I guess the uterine wall must be immoral as well. This is why we have to interfere. This is why we have to somehow prevent birth. Whether it be through contraception, whether it be chemically, whether it be, you know, surgically, we've got to intervene somehow. Because walls are immoral. And the whole thing, you know, it's people who believe that a border wall is immoral or that it doesn't work. These are people, they're puppets. They are puppets that go along with whatever their party tells them or whatever the news feeds them. Walls work. Chances are, as you are listening to this podcast, chances are you are behind walls. If you happen to be in your home, perhaps, you are behind walls. Walls protect us, do they not? You are being protected by walls as we speak. You are being protected from the elements. You know, it's cold right now throughout the country. You are being protected from the elements. You are being protected from the cold weather. If it rains, you are being protected from the rain. If it snows, you are being protected from the snow by walls. You are being protected from the enemy. There are many people out there who mean to do us harm, who want to break into our homes and, you know, do us harm and perhaps steal our stuff or what have you. But it just so happens that our stuff is behind walls, which makes it harder for them to get to, does it not? Do you have money? Do you have cash? Do you have jewels? Do you have jewelry? Maybe you keep your cash, maybe you keep your jewels, maybe you keep your jewelry, anything that is important or valuable to you, documents, maybe you keep them in a safe. What is a safe? Four walls around your cash, four walls around your jewelry, four walls around your important documents. Protecting your documents keeps people out of your jewelry. It keeps people, keeps criminals out of your important stuff, out of your valuable stuff. Walls work. We are surrounded by walls at all times. Everywhere we go, there's walls. You know, these people that advocate for no walls at the border, at the southern border, do these people, do they go home and leave the back door open at night? No, they don't. They check their windows, make sure the windows are locked. They check the front door, they check the back door. Because they want to feel secure in their own homes. Right? These people, they don't leave their back door open at night. And yet, they want the back door to our country open at night, open during the day, open at all times, right? And who knows who is making their way through that border? Who knows, right? We know that a whole lot of criminals are making their way through the border. A whole lot of drugs are making their way through the border. A whole lot of sex slaves are making their way through the border. Thanks to sex traffickers, right? We know that a whole lot of bad stuff is making its way through the border as we speak. Right? And, You know, a lot of that bad stuff we are able to keep out of our homes. Why? Because we are surrounded by walls. That's why. There sits Nancy Pelosi in the White House, the most fortified walls in the world, saying that walls don't work. And people believe it. And people believe it. Democrats, I'm talking about voters, Democrat voters will believe that. Stop and think. Stop and think. When you tell, you know, someone you're having a discussion with, and you tell them that walls don't work, where are you at that moment? Are you sitting behind walls? Are you being protected by walls as you speak? Walls work. But you've got Nancy Pelosi out there.
The fact is, a wall is an immorality. It's not who we are as a nation.
It's not who we are as a nation. Infanticide. That's who we are as a nation, as far as Democrats are concerned. Infanticide. And then you've got Cardinal Dolan out there. He's asked about Cuomo. Should the guy be excommunicated? Should we excommunicate Cuomo for being a Catholic and supporting such an extreme abortion law?
There are calls from people in the Catholic Church for Governor Cuomo to be excommunicated. Mm-hmm. From the Catholic
You're Church. Telling me. I get wheelbarrows of letters every day. I think that would be counterproductive myself. For one...
Well, he's not following Catholic doctrine.
Well, I don't know if this... But there's my point, Steve. We would be giving ammo to our enemies who say, this is an internal Catholic disciplinary matter. This is really not civil rights. This is really not biology. These Catholics don't have freedom when it comes to this. I think we'd be given our enemies ammo.
The Catholic Church, Cardinal, stands against abortion. And here is the most prominent Catholic in the state of New York, and he's saying, oh, yeah, this is a good thing.
And the canon laws, which you, thank you, quoted, would also say that you have to use it for a medicinal purpose, and you think that there's going to be a good effect that can come out of this. We have a governor that brags about it. We have a governor that uses his dissent from church teaching as applause lines.
In fact,
we have a governor that takes quotes from Pope Francis out of context to draw an artificial cleavage between the bishops of New York and the Holy Father himself. He's not going to be moved by this. So what would be the use?
What would be the use? What would be the use? The use would be that Catholics may not be confused about the matter. Because here you have a prominent Catholic, Cuomo, Governor Cuomo, a prominent Catholic, claims to be a Catholic, publicly claims to be a Catholic, and yet supports, signs into law, as a matter of fact, he signs into law an infanticide bill. This is beyond abortion. And so, at the very least, excommunicating Governor Cuomo would mitigate confusion. The church is buried in confusion today. We've got confusion coming out of the Vatican. We've got confusion coming out of Pope Francis. We've got confusion coming out of Cardinal Dolan. We've got confusion coming from the clergy. We need to mitigate confusion. I know, Cardinal Dolan is right. It's not going to do anything as far as Governor Cuomo's concerned. You know, he will probably wear it as a badge of honor. But the Catholic Church should act for the sake of other Catholics who are being scandalized, who are being confused by the actions of this so-called Catholic. We need members of the clergy who have with a spine. Cardinal Dolan has no spine. Cardinal Dolan is part of the problem. Part of the reason why we are in the mess that we are in is because of members of the clergy like Cardinal Dolan has no guts. What use would excommunicating Governor Cuomo, what use would that be? What use are you, Cardinal Dolan? Why are you there? I have no use for members of the clergy like you. Catholics have no use for members of the clergy like you. Grow a spine, Cardinal Dolan. Grow a spine. I'm tired of these mamby-pamby Catholics, not only within the clergy, but within the lay community. These mamby-pamby, non-judgmental Catholics. You know, I was on Facebook the other day, and, you know, a friend of mine posted an article. And I forget exactly what it was about, but it had to do with our bishop here in the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky. And I made a comment. Oh, I remember. It's about the Covington boys, right? You know, the Covington boys and that Indian guy, you know, and, you know, our bishop makes a comment in an article that, wearing a MAGA hat, Make America Great Again hat, is not very pro-life. And I'm thinking, really? So that's not pro-life? We've got perhaps the most pro-life president this nation's ever known. He's packed the court with a... And look, you never know where that's going to go. You never know how a judge is going to rule. But he's packing the court with conservatives, okay? And I know that doesn't mean you can have a conservative on the court. He might vote the other way, right? But the more conservatives you have within that court, the better the chances, right? But anyway, we have perhaps the most pro-life president we've ever had in Donald Trump, whether you like to admit it or not, right? He is pro-life. His actions are pro-life. Is wearing a MAGA hat pro-life? I don't know if the hat itself indicates that that you're pro-life, right? But the last time I checked, sodomy is not pro-life, and our bishop, Bishop John Stowe, seems to advocate it, seems to support it. And so I posted this on this article. I made a comment on this article that a friend of mine posted on Facebook, right? And right away I get Father Stuart Woods, have no idea who he is. But he says, oh, I know Bishop John Stowe, and I know that he doesn't support sodomy. And I'm thinking, really? Where's he been? Okay? Here's a report locally here, the mainstream media here locally in the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky, reported the following last year during Pride Month. Take a listen.
As you drive past St. Paul Catholic Church, these bells may be the first thing to get your attention. But when you look up, this banner might make you take a second look.
This is a church that's open to all people, and hopefully this sign gets that across.
All are welcome. That's the message this Catholic church is sending as thousands of people prepare to walk downtown for the annual Pride Festival.
I don't think a Catholic church has ever had a sign like this before in front of it during Pride Week or any other time. However, in other parts of the country, we see this regularly.
Father Chris Clay sent a message to St. Paul parishioners explaining this banner is, quote, a small way of counteracting any experiences of hostility, rejection, and silent treatment that LGBTQ Catholics may have experienced.
That our LGBTQ sisters and brothers should not be afraid to come in here, will not feel judged, will not feel as though they're trampling on territory that isn't theirs. This is their home, and we want them to know that.
Making this kind of statement is a decision a spokesperson for the Diocese of Lexington says is up to each parish. For people like Nick Ralston, he's glad to see that.
It's up to each parish, according to the spokesperson of the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky, speaking for the bishop. Spokesperson speaks for the bishop, right? And so the spokesperson of the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky, is saying it's up to individual parishes. That kind of tells me that the bishop of the Diocese of Lexington, Kentucky, is in support of sodomy. So I don't know where Father Stuart Woods has been, but he must not know Bishop John Stowe as well as he thinks he does, right? Bishop John Stowe has gone on Catholic radio here locally and has misrepresented the teaching of the Catholic Church on homosexuality. Take a listen. This is Bishop John Stowe.
And so I have come to know individuals who are associated with New Ways Ministry, not the organization itself, but individuals associated with them. And every one of them that I have spoken to are genuine, sincere people of faith who are trying to reconcile their own sexual orientation with the church that they love and that they have been raised in. And they feel hurt that the church defines them as intrinsically disordered.
The church defines them as intrinsically disordered. The church does not define individuals as intrinsically disordered. It defines acts as intrinsically disordered. This is it's an outright lie to say that the church defines people, individuals, homosexuals, as intrinsically disordered. It is the acts they commit that are intrinsically disordered.
I think it is fair to say that the language is not helpful, although we strive and do our best to explain what that language means. The philosophical system out of which that kind of language arises. But, you know, we live in an age of...
And so the language, Catholic language, the language of the Catechism of the Catholic Church is hurtful. It is not helpful. And perhaps it might come across as hurtful if you're listening to Bishop John Stowe explain it and say that the Catholic Church defines the individual as intrinsically disordered. This is an outright lie. I'd be hurt as well if the church defined me for whatever reason as intrinsically disordered, right? But it doesn't. Is the act of murder intrinsically disordered? Yes, it is. Is sin, put it that way, sin itself is intrinsic. Any act that is sinful, a sinful act is intrinsically disordered because it goes against the order of God. And so, of course, it's intrinsically disordered. There's no better way to say it, actually. If you are outside of the order of God, if the acts that you are practicing or taking part in are outside of the order of God, then those acts are intrinsically disordered. Not you, but the acts. And here's Bishop John Stowe once again on natural law.
There could be a whole realm of argument by, well, what does natural law actually teach us about same-sex behavior? If you find it naturally occurring in the animal world, if you find it naturally occurring in...
Naturally, that's the only place where you find it, I guess, perhaps naturally occurring is in the animal world, right? Because animals are not logical thinking beings. But that's the only place where you can find it, right? But it seemed to me he was about to say, you know, if you find it naturally occurring in the animal world, if you find it naturally occurring in the human world, right? It's like he was going in that direction and he catches himself. Take another listen.
There could be a whole realm of argument by, well, what does natural law actually teach us about same-sex behavior? If you find it naturally occurring in the animal world, if you find it naturally occurring among certain species. So,
what other species are there, right? You've got the animal species and then you've got the human species. What other species are there?
It both can be clarifying, but it also raises other questions. Hmm. So certainly our much of our sexual morality is based on what is the purpose, what is the natural purpose for the sexual act? And our answer is that it's unitive and procreative. Right. And so that becomes the basis for all of, our understanding of what sexual activity is about. Mm. But there are other frameworks for understanding, and those are what theologians put together. It's, theology is a step towards doctrine. It's not the same.
So it seems to me our bishop is misrepresenting the teaching of the Catholic Church. It is not the individual who is intrinsically disordered. It is the act. Natural law. Natural law. There is no justification for sodomy within the natural law. No justification whatsoever. And yet it seems as if he's fishing, right? Looking for some justification within the natural law for sodomy. This is a misrepresentation of the teaching of the Catholic Church. And then he says the following.
But, so for a person, let's say, who is self-identified as gay or lesbian as a Catholic, you would say that they can hold out in their spirit, if not in their lifetime, that there is a possibility that someday the Church could view those acts as morally licit?
I don't want to go that far. I don't know that that would ever be the outcome of it.
What do you mean you don't know whether that would be the outcome of it? It will never be the outcome of it. That should be the answer. The Catholic Church has opposed homosexuality from her inception. Prior to that, right? Prior to the Catholic Church being founded by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ while he walked this earth, homosexuality was a sin. Sodomy was a sin, has always been a sin. What do you mean? I don't know if that will ever be the outcome. It will never be the outcome. You never know with Pope Francis, right? You just never know, right? If you can undermine the teaching of the Catholic Church as it pertains to the death penalty, as it pertains to communion for the divorced and remarried, who knows, right? Who knows what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, what God is going to allow this Pope to get away with? Right? If he is the Pope, right? I mean, it's getting to the point where, is the Pope Catholic, right? Is the Pope Catholic? He's about as Catholic as Governor Cuomo. About as Catholic as Nancy Pelosi, this Pope, But, it's amazing. It's amazing. But, do not fear. Bishop John Stowe, he also has said the following.
We can't say that these teachings are immune from ever changing. I, as a bishop, have promised to uphold the teachings of the Church as they are now, and I intend to do that completely.
He intends to do that completely, but yet at the same time, he says, we're not immune. These teachings are not immune from ever changing. What do you mean? They are immune from ever-changing, his teachings on sodomy. They are immune from ever-changing. They will never change. He himself seems to be holding out hope that maybe they will at some point. These teachings are not immune from ever changing, but yet I plan to uphold the teaching of the Catholic Church completely. How do you do that? On the teaching of the Catholic Church on homosexuality, and yet go out and speak before New Ways Ministry. How do you do that? How do you do that and at the same time serve as ecclesial advisor for fortunate families? A group of so-called Catholics who oppose the teaching of the Catholic Church on homosexuality, on sodomy. How do you do that? Fortunate families, from their mission statement, we believe, along with mainstream science, that the homosexual orientation and experience of gender is deeply seated and cannot be reversed by prayer and or therapy. Except that St. Paul says the complete opposite. He says, you used to be sodomites. You used to be sodomites, right? In other words, you're not any longer, right? You used to be. In other words, it can be reversed. Homosexuality can be reversed by prayer, right? We do know that. We don't know about therapy, right? Because therapy, scripture doesn't speak on therapy, and so we have no clue, right? But as far as our faith is concerned, we are told by St. Paul, you used to be sodomites, right? But the mission statement continues. It says, many of our LGBTQ children and brothers and sisters are in loving, committed relationships with persons of the same sex or persons with other gender non-conforming expressions and ask us as parents to embrace, accept, and love them for who they are. We do embrace our children, knowing that our decision to love our children and all LGBTQ persons at times places us in tension with church teaching. I don't think there's any tension there, okay? Because they are completely rejecting the teaching of the... There's no tension. There's just rejection. That's all there is. No tension, rejection. Okay? And they continue, as family, friends, and allies, we recognize that parts of official church teaching on this topic, while sincerely articulated by the church, is perceived as hurtful and disrespectful by many LGBTQ Catholics. Sounds just like Bishop John Stowe, does it not? While sincerely articulated by the church, is perceived as hurtful and disrespectful by many LGBTQ Catholics who seek to be welcomed by the church. We need to acknowledge that many of our children, family members, friends, fellow LGBTQ Catholics are in committed, loving, same-gendered relationships. We need to acknowledge it. In other words, we need to accept it as Catholics, right? This is in complete contradiction of the teaching of the Catholic Church. This group, fortunate families, they are in complete contradiction of church teaching. And yet Bishop John Stowe, who says...
We can't say that these teachings are immune from ever changing. I, as a bishop, have promised to uphold the teachings of the church as they are now, and I intend to do that completely.
Serves as ecclesial advisor to fortunate families. Let's go ahead and leave it there. We will see you next time on Cafeteria Catholics. Please pray. Please pray for my aunt, Cristina Garcia. Please pray for my uncle, Gregorio Garcia. Please pray for this great country of ours. As you know, fellow Catholics, this great country of ours is in dire need of prayer. And of course, please pray for the Catholic Church. See you next time, fellow Catholics. God bless.
into Morocco.